Good evening, everyone. Great to see you. Thank you very much indeed for coming back for our evening service. And if you're visiting with us tonight, we're absolutely delighted to see you. Thanks for joining with us, and we hope that this evening is a blessing to you. I'm just going to run through two or three announcements, really, and then I'll hand over to Mark. Just a reminder to our church family task team, we meet on Tuesday evening at 7:30 in the manse. And then Wednesday evening is our established evening. It'll be a prayer time this week from 8 until 9 in the minor hall. It's a very informal, but it is an important meeting as we have a lot of things to be praying about. So we'd love to see a lot more people join with us at our prayer times. If you're free on Wednesday evening and can come, please do. That's 8 o'clock Wednesday. Next Sunday, Mark will look after the morning service for us, continuing with the series that we started this morning, Love Your Church, and then I'll take us further into Malachi next Sunday evening. There's no kids zone next week because of the half term. And then just a date for your diary, Mark's licensing service will be on Friday evening, the 11th of November. That will be in Waringstown Presbyterian. And I know Mark would love a good number from New Mills to join us for that. If you're free on the 11th of November, there's a sheet that you can sign down in the back. That's just to help give the Waringstown folk an idea of our numbers to help with their catering. Just a wee reminder that at our evening services, we just have the offering plate at the door. There's no offering during the service, just at the morning services. I think that's all I need to say. Oh yes, just when we're thinking about licensing services, Mark and I and a few of us were at Jeff Gaughan's licensing. That was in Enniskillen Presbyterian yesterday afternoon. We had a good afternoon with Jeff and we sent him your greetings. I don't know whether really that was true because you weren't really sending your greetings, but I just said them anyway. And he was very pleased with that. So thank you.
He also spoke very fondly of his time here in New Mills, didn't he, Gordon? We even got a few tears from him when he talked about New Mills. So he appreciated being here as much as you appreciated having him here. It's great to see you this evening as we continue to open up the book of Malachi, as we worship God together, to see our young people as they're here for the first part of the service and then as they head down to YF. We're going to be thinking about a passage that reminds us and calls us of our great need to honor God. So we want to read a few verses from Psalm 145 as our call to worship this evening. And then after that, I'll pray and use some of those verses and those thoughts from them to shape our opening prayer. So this is verses 1 to 7 of Psalm 145. And let me just apologize if I cough into this microphone at any stage during this evening. I've got a little bit of a tickle, so just bear with me if that happens. Psalm 145, I will honor you, my God the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. There you go. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. They tell of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. Let's pray together before we come to sing of God's righteousness. Let's talk to God in prayer. Our God and our King, we do come tonight to honor you, to extol you, to lift your name high, to give you the praise that you are deserving of forever and ever. God, we confess that we have not praised you every day. That, God, this very week there have been days where you have been a second thought to us. Days where we haven't said thank you or we haven't said sorry. Days where we have taken our concerns and our worries to all kinds of people, but not to you. So God, as we come to worship you, we seek your forgiveness for our faults and for our failings, for our forgetfulness, in who you are and what you have done for us. God, realign our hearts tonight so that when we leave this place in the week ahead, we will have you at the forefront of our mind. We will indeed praise you every day. God, we hear in your word that your greatness no one can fathom, and we know that that is so true, God, that you are so different from us, that to fully understand and to fully comprehend you is so far beyond what our minds and our hearts can do. Yet, God, we pray tonight as we come to your word, as we pray and we sing praise, that, God, you will just give us a little bit more in our understanding, in our knowledge, in our love for you. God, help us to fathom you just a little bit more tonight. God, we thank you for our service this morning. We thank you for the sacrament of baptism that we witnessed, for that lovely Taylor family. And God, we're reminded that you call us to tell your great works and your mighty deeds to the next generation. God, even tonight, equip us as a church to do that. Help us to understand more how we meditate on your wonderful works. Equip us better. God, inspire us to use our gifts and our abilities to proclaim your great deeds to the next generation, to the community around us, and to a world that is so deeply in need. God, now as we come to sing to you, we want to celebrate your abundant goodness. We want to joyfully sing of your righteousness. And God, whatever might have went on this week, God, however we might be feeling as we come in to this place, God, as we come to sing of your goodness and your grace, God, fill us with joy. Joy that others wouldn't understand, perhaps considering the circumstances that we are going through, but joy that comes from our great Savior, and joy that cannot be taken away. We ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to hand over to Dave, and he's going to lead us in two songs.
Stand the same.
Oh, I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. And every single lie that tells me I will never more than just the thumb of every high and every low. Remind me once again just who I am, 'cause I need to know. Oh, you say I am loved, and I can't strong, and I think I am weak. You say I am held, and I am falling short. When I don't belong, you say I am yours. And I believe, yes, I believe what you say. Everything you think of me. In you I find my worth, in you I find my identity. Oh, you say I am loved, and I can't feel a thing. You say I am. I think I am weak. You say I am held, and I am falling short. When I don't belong, you say I am yours. And I believe, yes, I believe what you say.
Thanks, Dave. I just want to talk about my licensing for a second. I know Gordon has given it a plug, but I've been asked this question quite a few times. What is a licensing? And I didn't really have an answer, I have to say. I was pretty confused about what a licensing was as well. Whenever I sent the information through to my mum, she said very excitedly, "Oh, can I call you a reverend now?" I said, "No, definitely not. That is not what it's about." So I was talking to my father-in-law last weekend, and he was asking me lots of questions so that he could try and figure out what it was. And eventually, after I had said a few things and answered a few questions, he says, "Oh, right, Mark, So it's like you're getting your R plates. And I was like, yes, that is actually a wonderful analogy for what is happening. So it marks a point in time where you have completed your studies, where you've done a certain degree of what the Presbyterian Church have asked you to do, and they want to mark that because you've completed something, but they're not quite ready to let you out in the wild yet. There are still some restrictions. There are some things you can do and freedoms you can do. So I'll be able to marry people once I'm licensed, which is very exciting. You can form an orderly queue later on, and I'll sort that out for you. But you still can't do the sacraments. There are restrictions. You can do some things, and you can't do everything. So it is a significant moment where they want to say, you've got to this point, and we're letting you out loose a bit, but there are still some restrictions. But once you've got a bit more experience, and you've done a few more things, then hopefully in a few years, they will eventually let you free. And who knows what might happen then. Scary thoughts. So hopefully that gives you an idea of what it is. As Gordon said, it would be lovely for us as a family to have you there. It's a Friday night. I understand that doesn't work for everyone, and it can't work for everyone. But you'd be very welcome. You'd be very welcome. Warringtown, I think, is a church quite like this. It's very welcoming. They'd be thrilled to see you there. And we as a family would love to have you along. We're going to read from God's word. We're going to do two readings tonight. This first one from Numbers 25 is to help us understand something that we're going to come and think about in Malachi. So we're going to read Numbers 25, verses 1 through to verse 13. It's on page 164 of your pew Bible, and I'll give you a little second to find that. So Numbers chapter 25, starting at verse 1, and as I say, this will help us when we hear this story to understand some of what we're going to think about later. Let's hear God's word for us tonight. While Israel was staying in Shittim, the men began to indulge in sexual immorality with Moabite women, who invited them to the sacrifices, to their gods. The people ate the sacrificial meal and bowed down before these gods. So Israel yoked themselves to the Baal of Peor, and the Lord's anger burned against them. The Lord said to Moses, "Take all the leaders of these people, kill them, and expose them in broad daylight before the Lord, so that the Lord's fierce anger may turn away from Israel." So Moses said to Israel's judges, "Each of you must put to death those of your people who have yoked themselves to the Baal of Peor." Then an Israelite man brought into the camp a Midianite woman right before the eyes of Moses and the whole assembly of Israel while they were weeping at the entrance to the tent of meeting. When Phinehas, son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the priest, saw this, he left the assembly, took a spear in his hand, and followed the Israelite into the tent. He drove the spear into both of them, right through the Israelite man and into the woman's stomach. Then the plague against the Israelites was stopped. But those who died in the plague numbered 24,000. The Lord said to Moses, "Phinehas, son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the priest, has turned my anger away from the Israelites. Since he was as jealous for my honor among them as I am, I did not put an end to them in my zeal. Therefore, tell him, I am making my covenant of peace with him. He and his descendants will have a covenant of lasting priesthood because he was zealous for the honor of his God and made atonement for the Israelites." Amen. And we thank God for his word. We're going to continue to praise him as we stand and sing together, Name of All Majesty. And as we do, the young people can head down to YF. Let's praise God together.
Thank you.
We're going to read together again, this time our passage from Malachi. So if you want to open up the Pew Bible again, or if you have a Bible with you, and turn to Malachi chapter 2, we're going to read from verse 1 through to verse 9, page 961 of your Pew Bible. Malachi chapter 2, and again we trust that this is God's word for us this evening. And now, you priests, this warning is for you. If you do not listen, and if you do not resolve to honor my name, says the Lord Almighty, I will send a curse on you, and I will curse your blessings. Yes, I have already cursed them, because you have not resolved to honor me. Because of you, I will rebuke your descendants. I will smear on your faces the dung from your festival sacrifices, and you will be carried off with it. And you will know that I have sent you this warning, so that my covenant with Levi may continue, says the Lord Almighty. My covenant was with him, a covenant of life and peace, and I gave them to him. This called for reverence, and he revered me and stood in awe of my name. True instruction was in his mouth, and nothing false was found on his lips. He walked with me in peace and uprightness, and turned many from sin. For the lips of a priest ought to preserve knowledge, because he is the messenger of the Lord Almighty, and people seek instruction from his mouth. But you have turned from the way, and by your teaching have caused many to stumble. You have violated the covenant with Levi, says the Lord Almighty. So I have caused you to be despised and humiliated before all the people, because you have not followed my ways, but have shown partiality in matters of the law. Amen. We thank God that his word is living and active. And let's pray now, as we come to think about it, that God will truly speak into our lives. God, it's wonderful that this, your word, written long ago, is alive for us tonight. Father, we ask that you will take the bare bones of what I have here. You will put muscle and flesh and make it live for us tonight through your Spirit. God, may we have ears to hear, hearts to respond, hands to act on what we hear tonight. God, come and speak to us for your good, for our good, and for the glory of your Son Jesus. Amen. Commentator Andrew Peterson writes this, reflecting on these verses in the book of Malachi. A failure of leadership has consequences not only for the leaders, but for the people they lead. You're maybe thinking, Mark, we have had enough this week of failure of leadership. It feels like it's all we've been hearing for a few weeks, isn't it? It feels like it's all we've been hearing about for months and months and months. It seems like every time we go on to the news, the story is a failure of leadership. Now, I'm not wanting to preach a political sermon. I'm not wanting to be political in the pulpit, but it wasn't hard to figure out the example for the introduction tonight, really, whenever we're talking about a failure of leadership. We have had a leader who, according to his own party, lacked honesty and integrity. We have had a leader for a very short time who has had an incredible impact on our lives, not for the good. Perhaps it's a reality in your life that your mortgage payments could go up in the next few months by a considerable hundreds of pounds because of 44 days of failed leadership. And now, remarkably, as we come to think about a new leader for our country, there's the very real possibility that a lot of people who once upon a time said, we don't want that leader, because of a lack of integrity and honesty, are now saying, we would quite like that leader back. It's remarkable, isn't it? Utterly remarkable. But we truly are living in days where we get this. Like, I get this as I look at my bank balance and as I think about what my life is going to be like, trying to sort out my family in a few months down the line. We get this, don't we? A failure of leadership has consequences, not only for the leaders, but for the people that they lead. We feel this, we know this in our lives right now, in our political situation, in the country that we live in. And here in Malachi chapter 2, we're thinking about a failure in leadership, and we're asking this question tonight as we gather around God's word: what does God have to say to a failure in leadership that is having serious consequences for the people that they lead? This passage is really a continuation on from Malachi chapter 1, verses 6 to 14 that Gordon was taking us through a few weeks ago. The offerings, and if you were here, you'll know this. If you weren't, just to put you in the loop, the offerings that God's people have been presenting through the priests have been unfit and unworthy for the great King of heaven and earth. And now, as we come to this section, God, through Malachi, is taking an even more focused aim at the leaders of the people, the priests. I'm going to try my best to use the iPad to highlight a few things as we go along tonight, and hopefully you'll see what I'm doing up on the screen, and hopefully it will help us to follow along, and hopefully I'll get my lines as straight as possible. That's very important to me. But we start with verse 1, and now you priests, this warning is for you. So it's very clear, it's very explicit who this is for. This is for the priests, this is for the leaders of these people, the representatives who stand between God and them. It says in the NIV that this is a warning. But I want us to maybe think that a better word would be, or a different word would be better to use there. The word that's translated here in the NIV is warning, is really the word for command. It's the same word that is used in Exodus 24 when God invites Moses to come up on the mountain and to receive the law and the commandments. The same word used throughout the Old Testament to convey God's expectations of his people. And it's almost always translated as command throughout the Old Testament. Now, when we look at the context of this passage, we can understand why the NIV translators have chosen to use the word warning. But I think we lose something from it. We lose the seriousness of what is going on here, the seriousness of what is being said here. I'm just going to put command up here in my terrible childish writing. Because a warning's a bit different, isn't it? Maybe if you're not doing well in your work, you can get a verbal warning and then another verbal warning and then a written warning and another written warning, and you feel like, oh, I don't really have to pay that much attention, you know? Warnings we think we can get away with sometimes. But this is weightier. A command is different. It's got big connotations of how God has communicated to his people throughout history. It spells out exactly what God is expecting, what God is about to say to these priests is based on what he has said before to his people. God has shared his expectations. This isn't coming out of the blue. God has already told them what he expects of his people and of his leaders, and to use the word command helps us, reminds us of that, that God has already spoken and told them how they should lead, and he's coming to talk about it to them now. Jason DeRoshi, we used one of his books whenever we were in union called Understanding and Applying the New Testament. He talks about what the prophets do. When we turn to a book of the prophets in the Bible, what are they doing? And he says this: the prophets confronted Israel's sin, called the people back to their commitment to Yahweh, and reminded them of the covenant curses and blessings, the promises of death and life that Yahweh had sworn to honor. And that's exactly what's happening here in this passage. God is calling his people back to their commitment. He's reminding them of their covenant curses and blessings, the promises of death and life that he has made to them, and the fact that they have sworn to honor him. So what does he say as he comes to talk to the people about this Malachi? Let me just change the color to look extra fancy and jazzy, okay? Here's what he says to them at the start. If you do not listen, and if you do not resolve to honor my name, that's what this is all about. These priests and the people have not been listening. They have not been resolving. They have not been honoring. They haven't been listening to what God has been saying in the past. And now as Malachi comes to them, he's calling them to listen to him as he reminds them about all that God has said to them. They have not been resolving. They have not steadfastly been setting their hearts on leading the way God calls them to lead. And most significantly, because they haven't been doing those things, because they haven't been listening, because they haven't been steadfast in their faithfulness and resolve, God's name has not been honored. God's name has not been honored. And that's why he comes to them now with these very serious consequences. God lets him know, you haven't been following my command. You haven't been listening. You have not been resolving to honor my name. So what are the consequences? Malachi says this, I will send a curse on you, and I will curse your blessings. I will send a curse on you, and I will curse your blessings. If you were a priest, blessing was your business. That was part of your job, to, on behalf of God, bless his people. This morning, if you were here in church, we used one such blessing. We used the Aaronic blessing. We sang it over little baby Joel for his life ahead, asking that God would come and be with him, turn his face towards him. This was the job of the priests, to bless the people on God's behalf. But God is saying, I will send a curse on you. I will curse your blessings. The blessings that you give to the people will mean nothing. They will have no effect. In fact, God says, I have already cursed them because you have not resolved to honor me. This has already begun. The consequences of the leader's actions are already here. Eric Ortlund puts it like this, the curses for their covenant failure are already coming into effect, but are failing to break the people's stubborn refusal to reform their worship. That gets to the heart of what we're like, doesn't it? We are stubborn people. Sometimes God pokes us and prods us and speaks to us and says, come back to me, listen to me, resolve yourself towards me, honor me, but yet we're so stubborn and we continue not to. And this is what's happening here. They haven't been listening. They haven't been paying attention. God has already put some of these consequences into action, but he's calling them to return to him now. He's calling them to repent, and he's letting them know that time is short, that he will not wait forever. And the consequences continue to be spelled out. Because of you, I will rebuke your descendants. I will smear on your faces the dung from your festival sacrifices, and you will be carried off with it. Two things, descendants and dung. What a combination, eh? Descendants and dung. Because of you, I will rebuke your descendants. There's some debate about what this means. The word that's used there in the Hebrew is seed. And it could actually mean literal seed of the field, because the priests got, they were looked after by the prophets from the seed of the field. They were blessed by the prophets of the seed of your field. But it could also mean their seed, their descendants, as it has here. Because the priestly line was from father to son. It went through descendant to descendant. And most commentators think that's the most likely explanation of what this means here. That God is saying he will rebuke your descendants. Those who come after you, who should be priests, they won't be fit to carry out what they are called to do. This is language that we might not be accustomed to as we come to read God's word. I will smear on your faces the dung from your festival sacrifices. Peterson, again in his commentary, says, one must not domesticate the sharpness of God's word simply to cater for contemporary cultural sensitivities. This is language and imagery that's designed to offend as we hear it. Why? Because God is offended. God is offended by his leaders. Part of a priest's role was to be pure. Part of a priest's role was to be clean. That's why they had the right to come before God on the people's behalf. And God is saying, if you continue as you do, the word that's dung here that's used, it's the intestines, the leftovers of the animals that were used for sacrifices, the food that hadn't been digested. Leviticus 4:11-12 tells the people what they were supposed to do with that. But the hide of the bull and all its flesh, as well as its head and the legs, the internal organs and the intestines, that is all the rest of the bull, he must take outside the camp to the place ceremonially clean where the ashes are thrown and burn it there in a wood fire on the ash heap. This is the unclean stuff. This is the stuff that's been to be taken out of the temple and to be burned. And God is saying, if you continue in your ways, it's like I will smear you with this. It's almost a reversal of the Aaronic blessing that God will shine his face upon these people. Instead, he will cover their faces in dung. He will make them unclean. He will make them totally unfit for the job that he has made them to do. These priests and their descendants will be rendered utterly useless for the task God has called them. Like the leftovers, the intestines of the animals, they will be carried out because they are no good anymore. We're getting a sense, aren't we, how serious God is about this failure in leadership, the command he brings before them, and the consequences they will face if they do not return to him. And now as we move on in the passage, we see what this command that God brings to these people in this moment is based on. And it's their covenant calling. The covenant calling that the priests have received. Let's be cool and jazzy and change the color again. You will know that I have sent you this warning or command so that my covenant with Levi may continue. That's what it's all about. So that God's covenant can continue as it should. And this is where Phinehas comes in from our reading in Numbers 25. Because perhaps as you heard that read, you thought to yourself, well, I don't really know what a covenant with Levi is. What does that really mean? I don't remember God making a covenant with Levi in a particular way. And it's most likely that Malachi is referring to this moment with Phinehas, one of Levi's descendants. Let me read to you again what God says about Phinehas. Phinehas, son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron the priest, has turned my anger away from the Israelites. Since he was as zealous for my honor among them as I am, so different from the priest that we're talking about now, I did not put an end to them in my zeal. Therefore, tell him, I am making my covenant of peace with him. This is the covenant that Malachi is talking about. He and his descendants will have a covenant of a lasting priesthood because he was zealous for the honor of his God and made atonement for the Israelites. And that covenant, what it means, what it looks like, what it's all about, is now spelled out by Malachi here. What do we find out about it? My covenant was with him, a covenant of life and peace, and I gave them to him. Let me underline those words. A covenant of life and peace. That's the covenant that God wants his people to experience. Isn't that a beautiful way to put it? Isn't that a refreshment to our soul to hear it put like that? God wants us to enter into a covenant with him that will give us life and peace. What does it say after that? And I gave them to him. God is the one who gave Phinehas this covenant of life and peace. God is the one who desires to have us enter into a covenant of life and peace with him. Life and peace. Who doesn't want that? Who in our world doesn't want that? And God is the one who gives it then and who still gives it now. This covenant, what was it for? For reverence. And he revered me and stood in awe of my name. It's all about honoring God. It's all about revering God. When we enter into a covenant with him, God calls us to revere him, to honor him, to stand in awe of him. If we are covenant people, if we are covenant leaders, then true instruction was in his mouth. Nothing false was found on his lips. He walked with me in peace and uprightness and turned many from sin. If we are people of the covenant, if we are God's covenant leaders in his church, then this is what we are called to be and to do. True instruction was in his mouth. That's the call of leaders in this church. That's the call of those who stand before you in our different organizations, who open up God's word for you, that true instruction should be in their mouth, that nothing false should be found on their lips. Our leaders are called, we're all called, but particularly our leaders, as we think about in this moment, to walk with God in peace and uprightness and to turn many from sin. If we are a covenant leader, then the words that we speak and the life that we live, walking with God and peace, in peace and uprightness, should turn many from sin. That's what our covenant call as covenant leaders is to do, to turn many away from sin. The truth is that these priests hadn't been living up to this. The truth is that our leaders, let's be honest, even now can't live up to this. There is only one leader who has ever only had true instruction in his mouth, who has never spoken false words from his lips. One leader who truly walked with peace and uprightness before God. One leader who turns many away from sin, and that is Jesus. Phinehas is good, Jesus is better. The covenant was made with Phinehas, the covenant is fulfilled in Jesus. When we want to know what it looks like to live as covenant people, when we want to know what it looks like to live as covenant leaders, we look to Jesus. We see how he spoke. We see how he spoke. We see how he lived. And we see how he called. And through his death and his resurrection, how he turns many from sin. What is our call tonight as covenant people and as covenant leaders? To focus our eyes on our covenant Savior, Jesus, and to choose to follow and live for him. We've heard the command to listen, to honor God. We've heard about the consequences if these leaders don't. The covenant and the covenantal call has been laid out before these leaders. And then there is their leadership choice to make. Look what it says here at the end in verses 7 to 9. For the lips of a priest ought to preserve knowledge, because he is the messenger of the Lord Almighty, and people seek instruction from his mouth. But you have turned from the way, and by your teaching have caused many to stumble. You have violated the covenant with the Lord, says the Lord Almighty. So I have caused you to be despised and humiliated before all the people, because you have not followed my ways, but you have shown partiality in matters of the law. These leaders, these priests, have a choice to make. Will they return to God? Will they speak from their lips things that will preserve knowledge? Will they truly be what God has called them to be, messengers of the Lord Almighty? Will they allow people to seek instruction from their mouth that is true and that is honest and that is honoring and glorifying God? Or will they continue in their way? They have turned from God's way. Their teaching has caused many to stumble. I don't think there's anything worse that we could say about a Christian leader than that. That is utter and abject failure, that they have caused many to stumble. God have mercy on those leaders who are like that, who have caused many to stumble. This is the choice that is laid before these leaders. Will they continue to turn away from God's way? Will they continue to cause people to stumble, violating the covenant with Levi? If they do, they will be despised and they will be humiliated. That's God's warning. That's his command to them. But Malachi and what he says to this people is all about calling them to restoration. Come back, priests. Come back, leaders. Live in the covenant way. Do as God has called you to do. From your lips, speak truth so that knowledge can be preserved. Be messengers of the Lord Almighty as he has asked you to be. Eugene Merrill, another commentator, puts it like this: the charge is to give most careful heed to giving glory to the name of the Lord, best done by discharging their priestly responsibilities in line with Torah and with genuine devotion to God. Failing leaders have a choice to make. Will they continue in ways that cause many to stumble? Or will they repent and return to God, heeding the warning and the command that time is short? There are many leaders in our church. We have elders, we have leaders in different organizations. This is God's challenge for us tonight. Have we, and I include myself in this, of course I do, been living as covenant leaders? Have we been doing the things that God has called us to do? If we have been causing many to stumble, then please turn and repent. Please turn back to God and seek his restoration. I love the fact that God doesn't say, I'm done with you. There's no chance. There's no way back. He lays it out before them and he asks them to come back to him, to lead his people in the way that covenant leaders should do. And that's our challenge tonight. How are we going to lead? How are we going to lead God's people, knowing that failed leadership has serious consequences for the people we lead, but covenant leadership covenant leadership has abundant blessing. Let's pray together. God, we're told in your word that this is the sword of the Spirit. And sometimes it cuts us deep. Sometimes it cuts us open and exposes our flaws and our failings. God, we see in this passage how seriously you take the call to lead. God, how serious you are when you see that leaders are causing others to stumble. When you see that leaders aren't listening to you, setting their hearts after you, honoring you and calling others to honor you as well. God, for all of those who lead in this church in any capacity, Father, if we have failed you and if we have let you down, if we have caused others to stumble, God, send us speedily back to you, seeking your forgiveness and seeking your restoration. God, help us as the picture has been painted tonight of the kind of covenant you have made, a covenant of life and peace. God, captivate our hearts once again by the covenant you have made with us through our covenant-keeping Savior, Jesus Christ. God, restore us to leaders who do not cause others to stumble, but who call others away from their sin. And God, we pray for the leadership in our land. God, as it's worked out over the next week, who will be prime minister, who will lead this country, who will make significant decisions. God, we ask for leaders of integrity. We pray that you will be in the midst of all of the decision-making and voting to bring someone to lead our country who is honorable, who cares for those most in need, and who seeks to honor you in the decisions they make. God, we thank you for what we heard this morning as we set off on our Love Your Church adventure in our morning services, thinking about how we can go deeper together. God, lead us and guide us through those services, so that whether we're a leader or a congregation member, whatever role we have in this church, we can grow in our love for your people. We can grow in our love for our Savior Jesus. We can grow in our love for his bride, the church. And God, we pray for those in our congregation who are ill, who face uncertain times. We pray for those who are housebound and who are lonely, particularly as these short days and dark nights set in. God, we pray that they will know your covenant love. We pray that they will, deep down in their souls, feel that you're a God of life and peace, and that you're giving it to them now in even these most difficult moments. And God, we pray that as we leave this place, God, we won't leave your word behind, but we will take it and we will meditate on it. We will chew it over. And as we do, we will look to Jesus so that we can be changed and transformed into covenant children and covenant leaders who are more like him. In his name we pray. Amen. We're going to draw our service to a close as we stand and praise God, stand and honor his name as we sing Stand Up for Jesus.
Thank you.
Let's say the grace together to send us on our way. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.